This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman. On today's show, we talk poverty in America with The Nation magazine's Sasha Abramsky, author of a brand new book called The American Way of Poverty, How the Other Half Still Lives. It's published by Nation Books. Sasha Abramsky is the real deal. And after you hear this interview, I know you'll run out and buy his book as well as read them over at The Nation magazine, a magazine that you should all be subscribing to. Also, we talk about the plight of elephants in Africa with Georgia Umano, who helped organize the International March for Elephants earlier this month. She'll tell you what you can do to help save elephants in Africa. We're losing 115 a day. And we need elephants. This is an important show. It really is. And it's not as heavy as it sounds. You'll get angry, but I found it entertaining. Then again, I'm mentally ill. This is about poverty, stuff you need to know about poverty in America. And you need to know what's happening to the elephants in Africa. You just do. Let me just take care of a little business here. A few of you may have had trouble downloading Monday's show with The Nation magazine's Lee Fang and Down with Tyranny's Howie Klein. It turned out to be an incredibly popular show. I recommend it. It's a great show. Patton Oswalt loved it, and he linked to it through his Twitter account. And he pretty much crashed our server for about 30 minutes. He gummed up the works. We weren't prepared. So some of you went to download it and you couldn't access it. We've ungummed the works and you should have no problem downloading a really fascinating episode with investigative reporter for The Nation magazine, Lee Fang, who offers up some startling information about who exactly is funding the Tea Party and what the real Boston Tea Party was about. As I mentioned on that show, Thanksgiving is coming up, and if you really want to mess with your crazy uncle, you got to listen to this episode. It'll give you ammunition that'll give him agita and make his head spin. There's stuff about the Boston Tea Party that is, you got to listen to Lee Fang. This stuff, I hate to use the term blow your mind, but it'll just blow your mind about what the real Boston Tea Party was about. Howie Klein, the founder of Blue America, and he also writes the Down with Tyranny blog. He talks about Speaker John Boehner's alcoholism and, get this, John Boehner's Rastafarian daughter who just got married. I think that's why Patton loved that episode so much. It was the perfect mix of history and gossip. So if you haven't heard the episode, the Lee Fang, Howie Klein episode, you can download it now. It's available. We just had a little server problem due to Patton's recommendation. It's always nice when a guy who used to open for you is so powerful he can crash your server with one Twitter recommendation. I'm more than happy to eat Patton's dust. This is also a great show. It's perfect. We need to know this stuff. On today's show, Poverty in America and the Plight of Elephants in Africa. This is an important show. Make a cup of coffee. Listen up.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
I am thrilled to welcome to this program Sasha Abramsky, who writes for The Nation magazine. Sasha Abramsky is also the author of Inside Obama's Brain, Breadline USA, The Hidden Scandal of American Hunger and How to Fix It, his new book, The American Way of Poverty, How the Other Half Still Lives, is published by Nation Books. It came out last month, and you can order a copy at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, or IndieBound. Sasha Abramsky, thank you for joining us this morning.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me on.
You're talking to us from Sacramento, where you teach. What do you teach?
I teach writing at UC Davis, and in addition to writing, I also teach freshman seminars on poverty, which obviously deals very well with the work that I've been doing recently.
Considering the $1 trillion in student loan debt, do college students need to be taught about poverty?
Well, you know, it's one of the things that I write about a lot, which is that we've always thought of education as a ticket out of poverty. We've always thought of it as an upwardly mobile thing to do. And it's still true. But increasingly, one of the things you see is that over the last 10 to 15 years, the costs borne by individuals and by families of that education has gotten steeper and steeper. You see it in the UC system, where tuition fees basically doubled in a relatively short period of time. And you see similar things happening all over the country, that as public infrastructure comes under ever greater stresses, as tax revenues fall, at least in part because people at the top of the income chain are just paying less and less into the tax code, increasingly basic public goods, like public education at a public university, come to be paid for by individuals. And it does carry this huge debt risk. So one of the things you see is young adults starting out in life with tens and sometimes hundreds of thousands of dollars of student debt. It's like beginning life with a mortgage.
Right.
It has all kinds of implications. So that's one part of the puzzle that I was trying to put together in my book on poverty, but it's by no means the only one or the only trigger into poverty.
Right. And the money is there, correct? It's just the people who have it don't want to pay taxes.
Yeah, there's this fake analogy. People, especially conservatives, when they're talking about public infrastructure and public finances, they say, well, America's like Greece, and you need to look at Greece and see the danger of an indebted nation. And it's a fake analogy. Greece is a small country with an utterly bankrupt government structure, and basically every euro that Greece spends at this moment is borrowed money. If you want a medical analogy, Greece is suffering from a very, very serious illness that's corroding it from within. Mm-hmm. American system isn't like that. It's the biggest economy in the world. It's a $17 trillion powerhouse economy. It's got more billionaires than any other country. It's got more profitable corporations than any other country. And yet it's got a part of the political class that says we can't afford to preserve basic infrastructure. And so we're going to starve that infrastructure. We're going to take away resources from things like food stamps. We're going to take away resources from education programs. Now, that's not the Greek disease. That's anorexia. What it is it's America choosing, or part of America's political elite, choosing to self-starve the public infrastructure. That's psychological. It's this sort of fetishistic idea that taxes are always bad, no matter what they're spent on, that government programs can never do good, no matter who they're aimed at, and that we're all better off on our own. It's just not true.
Right.
There's no society on earth that has survived as atomistically as the society that we're trying to create, because realistically, many, many parts of our lives involve communal effort.
Right.
You can't build roads as an individual. You can't build schools as an individual. All of these things demand community involvement, and they demand, to a degree, public financing. And as long as that's the case, there has to be a tax base in order to finance that. But not purely for altruistic reasons, but if, as a society, we don't invest in basic public infrastructure, on the global stage, gradually America will become less competitive, because other countries are making those investments. Other countries are investing not just in parts of their society or parts of their population, but they're doing a much better job of keeping people out of poverty and of bringing those who fall into poverty back up to decent standards of living. And America's not at the moment. And that's a large part of my book, is addressing that question, why isn't America tackling these huge issues?
We're talking with Sasha Abramsky. He's the author of The American Way of Poverty. You're talking about the Greeks. You write about Pericles. What did Pericles have to say about economic inequality's effect on a democracy? Was he right? And who was Pericles?
Well, let me answer the last one first. Pericles was an Athenian statesman about 2,500 years ago. And he was a very interesting figure because he was, in many ways, a very modern political leader. He understood the dynamics of interactions between different parts of society. he understood something of the idea of a social compact. And one of the things that Pericles warned about, he was a very good speaker, he was a sort of Churchillian character. One of the things that he warned about was the idea that rampant inequality ends up undermining political stability. Instead of having common shared values and goals, you end up with a very fragmented society where a small elite is essentially trying to manipulate the decisions of the state to benefit only that elite. And he warned that in such an environment, basic structures break down, basic political compacts break down, the idea of democracy sort of ceases to hold true. Now, your question is he right? And I would argue that he is, that if you look at political experiments in democracy down the ages, they work so long as there's a sense of shared vision. And when they run into serious trouble is when one part of that society emerges almost as a plutocracy or an oligarchy, that they have a separate economic interest, they have a separate political interest, and they no longer really care or understand about the lives of the people far below them on the economic ladder. Now, one of the most interesting interviews I did when I interviewed hundreds of people around the country, and many of them were themselves living in poverty, but other people I interviewed were people who studied the implications of poverty and of inequality. And one of the people I interviewed was somebody at the Harvard Kennedy School of Government called Marshall Gantz. And Gantz said to me, well, if you try and analyze this and you put poverty as the centerpiece and you make poverty the problem, you're missing the point. And I said, why? He said, well, today poverty is the miner's canary. In the olden days, before they had gas monitoring equipment, the miners would take little birds, canary birds, down with them into the mines. And the birds were very sensitive to any gas. So if there was gas present, the birds would immediately drop dead. And the miners would run because they'd know that they were going to follow suit pretty soon if they didn't run. And Gantz said to me, well, you know, that's what modern day poverty in America is. It's a symptom of a much deeper problem. And I said, well, what's the problem? He said, the problem is the levels of inequality that we're allowing to grow up. And it's true. If you look at the last 40 years of American economic history, what you see is that year in, year out, at the bottom of the economy, workers are being paid less and less in real terms for their work. The poorest sector of the society is getting poorer. At the top of the economy, year in, year out since 1974, people at the top of the economy are getting wealthier. They're accumulating a greater percentage of the nation's assets. Now, if you look at data from the 1920s, the last time we had levels of inequality this profound in America was four generations ago, in the years leading up to the Great Depression. And it peaks in 1928. The middle class is hollowed out. The middle class survives for a while on debt. And then it all comes apart in 1929. You end up with the Great Depression.
Right.
The next time you see a peak in inequality like that is 2007, 2008. And the same thing happens. You have a hollowed out middle class, and then the economy collapses. And you end up with massive levels of unemployment. You end up with a housing crisis and skyrocketing poverty. And we're living in the aftermath of that.
We're living in the aftermath of it, but here's the problem. In 29, we used our credit to create the bubble, and then it crashed, and we dealt with reality, and we ushered in...
Well, that was exactly what I was going to say, which is that after 1929, the coda to that was the New Deal. The coda to that was the creation of Social Security, public housing, public works, all these things that helped eliminate stupendous levels of inequality. After World War II, you had the GI Bill, you had the expansion of the middle class. Now, the tragedy of the moment today is that even in the middle of the post-2008 recovery, we haven't reshaped the economy. So now what we're seeing is this plateaued level of inequality at this incredibly high level, a few people at the top controlling the resources of about 150 million people at the bottom. And that's something new. And to me, it signifies the emergence of a new American community. And it's not a very healthy community that's emerging.
No, it's not. So the takeaway from this is after the crash of 2008, there became an even greater concentration of wealth as a response to the Great Recession, whereas the Great Depression, the wealth was distributed. So the country maybe is going to look back at the Great Recession, what happened in 2008, as a hiccup. We may be in store for something even more cataclysmic than the Great Depression.
Well, I'm not sure we're going to look back at the Great Recession as a hiccup, but I think what happened was in the 1930s, the Great Depression intersected with a particular moment in history. And one of the things that you were seeing in the 1930s was that it was the culmination of decades of union organizing. And so you had a lot of people with a union consciousness who understood that poverty and inequality were intimately related, that if you could find ways to boost the wages of working Americans, that that was going to do something very profound to the economy. And that if you could find ways to introduce social insurance systems that would benefit ordinary Americans, things like Social Security, again, that was going to have a profound impact on the shape of the society. Now, one of the things that happened from the 1970s on in is, as conservative rhetoric around unions and around deregulation and around the evils of taxation and so on picks up pace, what you end up with is this collapse of a collective consciousness. So where once there were strong unions that actually were very successful in raising minimum wages, in creating things like the eight-hour workday, in creating defined benefit pensions, in making health insurance a basic part of a decent job, from the 1980s on in, that disappears. And it has really profound impacts. And one of the impacts it has is that it results in an absolutely stagnant minimum wage at the bottom of the economy. Another thing that it did is it shatters the consensus around progressive taxation. So if you go back 50, 60 years, people at the top of the economy were paying terrifically high levels of marginal tax on their income at the top. And those kind of policies were supported not just by Democrats, but also by Republicans, by presidents like Eisenhower and by presidents like Nixon. From the 70s on in, that consensus around progressive taxation breaks down. What you see is increasingly at the top of the economy, top tax rates go down, capital gains tax rates go down, and we had a discussion about this in the last presidential election when Mitt Romney had to admit that he was paying about 14% tax rates. When Warren Buffett went on TV and said, well, look, this is unfair. I'm paying a lower tax rate than my secretary. So you have this collapse in tax rates at the top. You then had this increase in corporate tax loopholes. You also had a collapse in the estate tax, because in previous decades, when large estates were handed down from one generation to the next, a significant part of that estate went back to the government in taxes. And there was double purpose for that. One purpose was so that you could have some revenues that could be used on social programming. But the other point was so that we didn't create a plutocracy, because America, in theory, has never been about inherited wealth. And that's broken down these days.
One of the first tenets of our new democracy was to get rid of primogeniture.
That's right, because we had this understanding that primogeniture basically created aristocracy. It created ever larger holdings that a few people at the top of the economy would benefit from. Now, we don't have primogeniture in the modern American economy, but we have something similar. We have this denuded tax base, which essentially allows vast amounts of wealth to be passed from generation to the next. And one of the effects of that is it means there's a small group right at the top of the economy. We talk about the top 1%, but in actual fact, it's the top 0.1 and even the top 0.01 who control absolutely vastly disproportionate amounts of wealth. And that's something that didn't exist from Roosevelt through to the 1970s. That didn't exist. It's a new phenomenon, and it's having all kinds of impacts on the broader economy.
It's sick and diseased, and it's wrong, because you have these children who don't work. They inherit millions, if not billions, of dollars. They keep the money to themselves, and they also really don't tell other people that they're being bankrolled by their parents. They walk around needing a shave. They've got jeans on and sneakers, and they give the illusion that it's a level playing field. And then all of a sudden, you're eating their dust. They turn 25.
I quite like this idea that, you know, in America, everybody defines themselves as middle class, in theory. So you have a billionaire who will say they're middle class, and you have someone on $20,000 a year who will say they're middle class. Now, in actual fact, they share very little economically in common. The billionaire is going to have almost every need catered to. The man or woman on $20,000 a year is going to be struggling to put food on the table for their kids. They're going to be struggling over how to buy prescription medication.
There's shame associated on both ends of the spectrum. There's shame associated with poverty. There's also shame associated with being the child of a millionaire or a billionaire who knows that he had a leg up over his competition. So they keep it to themselves. And what's so sick in this country right now is you have young adults who have been convinced that anybody can make it here in the United States, and they're competing at the office with somebody, or they have a friend who they don't know is the child of a billionaire, and all of a sudden they have this great job, or they have this, they were able to get funding for an idea. And if you dig deep enough, you find out, well, yeah, they're using their parents' money. But most of us don't know who the child of the billionaire is, because they're going to keep it to themselves. It's not a level playing field here. Very quickly, we started talking about Pericles and Greece. A lot of people listening are in crisis financially, but some people have money. What is happening in Greece right now with the rise of the Nazis and scapegoats? Just because you have money doesn't mean you're necessarily immune from the symptoms of a plutocracy.
Yeah, I mean, I love studying history, and I've read an awful lot of history over the years. And one of the things that you see when you look at history is that in moments when economies become very destabilized, that almost always it has a political ricochet effect. That if you collapse a middle class in the society, if you bankrupt people, if savings cease to be worth anything because of inflation or whatever the reasons, if you have wholesale economic crisis, usually you end up with political destabilization. You have people protesting on one side, people protesting on the other. You have an awful lot of anger. You have people looking for scapegoats. And you're right, you see that to a degree in Greece. You obviously saw it in a much more extended, damaging way in Europe after World War I, and it led to disastrous results. But historically, when you have profound levels of economic destabilization, it does filter into other areas of the society. Now, in America, it seems to me we've seen it to a limited degree over the last few years. You have these various different groups from the left and the right. You have Occupy on one side, you have the Tea Party on the other, you have various anti-immigration groups coming up. You have a whole bunch of groups with very inchoate discontents, and oftentimes those groups are very angry, and oftentimes they're looking for scapegoats, and it's not healthy. But the longer the political process ignores the scale of angst, not just of poverty, but of insecurity, of people not knowing what tomorrow is going to bring, people not knowing where they're going to get income to feed their children, of people not knowing how they're going to buy medicines if they get sick. The longer that level of systemic insecurity is allowed to fester, the more it's going to have political consequences. And I think we've seen that for the last few years. One of the things that concerns me about the moment is the political leadership in D.C. doesn't seem to have a roadmap to get out of this moment, which means that that insecurity is likely to continue to generate political instability. And that's got consequences, and it undermines the stability of the country. So I think it's something that has to be grappled with. And I think it's something that, you know, whether you're a Republican or a Democrat or anything else, this is a core issue. It's a moral issue, but as significantly, it's a political issue. It just has an impact on our society, and it needs to be addressed head on.
Now, I get a lot of criticism for comparing the Tea Party to the brown shirts and Mussolini. But the similarities are just glaring in that you have racist, poor people who are uneducated being manipulated by corporatists. And that is what the Tea Party is. They could very easily be turned into the jackbooted thugs who, you know, all it takes is one terrorist attack and a couple of buttons pushed by the Koch brothers to get these people changing their rallies into a riot.
I'm not sure I quite agree with the analogy. I think, you know, there are significant differences between where America is in 2013 and where Germany was 80 years ago.
Really?
Yeah. I do think there are differences, not the least of which is that for all the economic crisis of 2013 America, the scale of the crisis in Weimar Germany and the scale of economic collapse in Germany after World War I was that much greater. And instead of having a few million people who lost all their savings, you had almost the entire population having lost their savings. You had the majority of the country in Germany with nothing left to lose. So I do think there are historical differences. Now, that said, when you're talking about people being manipulated, I entirely agree with you that it seems to me that in the year 2013 in the United States, there are some very, very powerful economic interests who are using propaganda and using the politics of manipulation and the politics of bait and switch in a particularly dangerous way. And they're doing so in a way that could have profound implications for the way the democracy functions or doesn't function. And it seems to me that as soon as you engage in a politics of scapegoating, and there's no doubt about it, that the Tea Party and the elements of the corporate right at this point are engaging in some very dangerous scapegoating. As soon as that happens, you unleash some of the worst angels in the American body politic. And so I think, you know, as I said a minute ago, this is something that absolutely has to be addressed because the room for political crisis here is enormous.
The room for political crisis is enormous. And I'm getting tired of people saying to me, when you bring up Nazi Germany, you've lost the argument, because we invaded Iraq based on a lie. The American people were fed a lie that Saddam Hussein was behind 9/11, and half the country still believes that. The Tea Party, all of them believe it. The Tea Party, when you poll them, they all believe that Saddam had weapons of mass destruction. So it's very easy right now to spread the lie and repeat it over and over again, and enough Americans believe it. So not to compare America to Nazi Germany is a disservice to this country, because we are, I think, one terrorist attack away from doing some massive scapegoating. Another thing is, you say that, you know, after World War I, Germany was a lot worse off than the United States is. I want to get into your book. How bad is poverty in the United States? Because we don't talk about it.
Poverty in the United States is it's extremely bad, and it's extremely detrimental to the lives of tens of millions of Americans. Just coming back to what you were saying earlier, I'm going to disagree with you on this. I don't think the comparison between modern-day America and early fascist Germany makes much sense. I really don't. I think it's a different situation, and I think that the consequences of the collapse are playing out in different ways. But let me move on to the specifics. You asked about poverty. By government-owned measure, and the government's measures of poverty are very cautious. They err on the conservative side. By the government's own measure, one in six Americans nearly is in poverty. It's about 50 million Americans. About one in four, just under one in four children are in poverty in the United States. There's no other Western democracy, no other advanced democracy, full stop, where there are child poverty numbers anywhere near approaching what America has. And there's an extraordinary racial disparity here. African-American kids in many cities, two-thirds of African-American kids live in poverty. There are 6 million Americans of all races and ethnicities. There are 6 million Americans with no access to cash. They don't have jobs, they don't have savings, they don't have bank accounts, and they don't have cash government benefits. That's absolute poverty. They rely on food stamps, they rely on other handouts, but they have no form of cash. They're outside the modern American economy. What does it mean on a daily basis? Well, it means you've got people who are literally skipping meals. In the richest country on earth, you've got people who are going hungry. It means you have people who need medicines and they can't buy them, or they buy the medicines but then they can't buy shoes or other basic supplies for their kids. It means you've got millions of families who lost their homes or lost their stable living arrangements in the aftermath of the housing crisis. One of the things it means is that for millions of Americans, they're essentially marginalized and excluded from just everyday basic social interactions. Because we don't think about it, but most of the ways in which we socialize in this country take money. Mm-hmm. Even if it's a little bit of money, you go, you meet a friend for a coffee in a Starbucks, you spend a couple of dollars on the coffee, you sit down for an hour and you talk. If you're counting pennies, if you literally are down to counting pennies, well, that $2 coffee is an absolutely unaffordable luxury. And one of the things I found when I talked to people is that the loneliness and the isolation of American poverty is one of the most damaging impacts. And I was told this time and again by people, the sense of shame, the sense of isolation, the sense of humiliation, all of this for them was at least as important as the actual physical deprivation, the inability to buy food and so on. And for me, that was a real eye-opener, that there is a huge psychological cost that millions and millions of Americans are bearing. And that cost is to do with poverty amidst affluence.
Right. And we have a party of scolds, the Republican Party, which insists that if you're poor, it's your fault. So that just multiplies the shame associated with poverty. And you turn on the news and all you see are rich celebrities. They don't cover poverty in the United States. They used to. In fact, you wrote Inside Obama's Brain. He's talked about jobs, but he's never talked about poverty and hunger in America, has he?
Yeah, I find it one of the real frustrations about the administration is they clearly understand the issues. And there's some very smart people in the Obama administration who understand housing issues, they understand hunger issues, but they're very, very cautious. And I'm not quite sure why, but they're very, very cautious in actually talking about poverty head on. And none of them, from Obama down, none of them have done what Johnson did a half century ago and declare the moral urgency of poverty and declare the need to put all of the energies of the federal government behind anti-poverty efforts. And I think one of the problems is that if you don't talk about poverty using moral language, it's very hard to bring people along. If you do talk about it using moral language, well, you create the space for empathy. And Johnson understood that very, very well in the early 60s, that if you could find moral language, if you could do what Martin Luther King was doing around race, and hold up a mirror to America and say, well, look, here's a set of ideals that you profess to have, but here's the reality, which is what Martin Luther King did in the I Have Dreams speech. Well, Johnson does the same thing around poverty. He basically says to America, you have a set of ideals, now let's live up to them, not just for 70 or 80% of the population, but for everybody. And he puts a lot of federal moral energy in play. And so far, the Obama administration, even though, as I said, I think they understand the issues, they haven't unleashed that moral energy. And that, to me, is one of the great sadnesses of the last few years.
Right. There was a moral energy in the Great Society program under LBJ, but they also called it a war on poverty.
I was going to say, with hindsight, it sounded good at the time. With hindsight, I think it was a terrible phrase.
It's a horrible phrase because America can't win wars anymore.
Well, I mean, whether or not America can win wars, you can't win a war against a social phenomenon. Poverty is not one thing. It's a set of very complicated interplays of individual circumstance and group circumstance.
Right.
And you can't win a war. It's not an all or nothing thing. You're not going to be able to sign an armistice and say, all right, the war is won, poverty has been defeated. That's not how it works. And so I think it set the conditions for backlash.
It was a war on poverty. We don't win wars. We lose wars. We lost Vietnam. We lost both wars in Iraq. We're losing in Afghanistan. When we fight wars, we have no money to deal with poverty. And by calling it a war on poverty, it summons the worst impulses of Americans in that we can't be defeated. What is the truth about America is we can't admit defeat. Nobody in America is willing to admit that we lost Vietnam, that we lost Iraq, and we're losing Afghanistan. And the reason Reagan was able to come into office and trample on welfare queens is we were stupid enough to think we won the war on poverty because Americans can't admit that they lost a war. We lost the war on poverty, but when you put war next to something, we always think we won. We did win during the 60s. There was a brief period that LBJ was able to bring down the poverty rate, right?
Yeah, I mean, for 10 years, it wasn't just LBJ. Throughout the Johnson presidency and the Nixon presidency, poverty went down. It goes down to 11% by 75, and that's the lowest it ever was in America. So, my problem with the phrase war on poverty isn't that wars are unwinnable necessarily. It's that in this particular instance, it should never have been framed as an all or nothing proposition. In the same way as the war on drugs dramatically oversimplifies very, very complicated social problems and sets up this absolutely unwinnable situation. You're never going to get 100% of Americans to stop taking drugs. Mm-hmm. You might have more or less success in getting more or less people to stop taking. It's the same thing with poverty. It was a utopian phrasing. A war on poverty to eliminate poverty set the stage for failure because even though millions of Americans were taken out of poverty, even though Johnson's programs around Medicare and around nutritional assistance and job training and so on had tremendous impact, they still left some people in poverty, a large enough number so that people could look around, they could see poverty in existence on city streets, in rural areas and so on. And without knowing the underlying data, they could say, ah, the war on poverty is a failure. And yet we're spending all this money, all of our hard-earned tax dollars are going into it. Well, what's the point? So it sort of sets the stage for backlash. If Johnson had done a better job of saying, look, we're not going to eliminate poverty, but we're going to put all our energies into limiting it and into mitigating the consequences, well, I think people would have had more tolerance for it over the long haul. Instead, what we had was this all-or-nothing proposition. And so by the time Reagan comes along, it's judged a failure.
Right.
And so you start throwing out the good with the bad. So, yes, some war on poverty programs were probably badly designed, probably didn't get much bang for the buck, but many others did. But the whole thing goes out of fashion, and it becomes ever more fashionable to blame the poor for being poor, to use the sort of Victorian 19th century language that blames poverty on poor people, instead of looking at the structures. Instead of saying, well, you know, if you have inequality of the levels we have, you're going to have poverty. If you stagnate the minimum wage, well, you're going to have the working poor. If you have an undocumented migrant population with no workplace protections, well, then you're going to have a whole bunch of people at the bottom of the economy essentially working in servitude. And I think that the language around poverty became more and more simplistic from the 80s to the 90s to the 2000s, more about blaming, more about scapegoating. And one of the consequences is now we have this absolutely epidemic level of poverty. One in six Americans are poor. About one in three Americans are near poor. And yet we've lost the language at the policy level that will allow us to engage this properly, allow us to talk about the problem in the way it needs to be talked about, or allow us to talk about the kind of broad systemic solutions that need to be put into play.
Why have we lost the language? Why can't a politician say one-third of American children are, because I think it is one-third of American children, one-third of American children experience food insecurity. Isn't that the end of the discussion? Why can't...
One would have thought it should be that, you know, as soon as you mention statistics that overwhelming, you should have a way into a conversation about solutions, and that hasn't happened. I think one of the things is this denuded language that blames the poor for their poverty. And it's a very ingrained language. It's got a lot of adherence in rant radio and shock TV and all these other areas. And it also plays into a large part of the political narrative. And, you know, one of the things we've seen is as wealth has accumulated toward the top of the economy, so political influence has accumulated towards the top.
They attack you personally when you say, okay, I will accept the fact that everybody in poverty, it's their fault. One-third of American children experience food insecurity. So should we put them to work? What did these children do?
You did see that in the last presidential election. You had Newt Gingrich going around the country saying he was going to propose dramatic reforms to child labor laws that would allow children to work on the assumption that if you had children working for a dollar or two an hour, you'd somehow restore the American dream because kids would pull themselves up by their bootstraps. That's absolutely nonsense. If you destroy child labor laws that were built up over a century, you don't take people out of poverty. You condemn people to poverty. You condemn people to a lifetime of low-skill, low-wage employment. It's great if you're the employer. It's awful if you're the employee. But I think that that's kind of where we are in the political debate at the moment. At least a part of the political process believes that any and all government intervention, including labor protection laws built up from the early 20th century onwards, are illegitimate.
Okay.
Until we get beyond that, until we say that in some circumstances, not all, but in some circumstances, regulations are good, they're necessary, and they level the playing field. Until we get beyond that, we're going to be in this crisis situation where poverty numbers escalate and our ability to tackle poverty diminishes.
You have a plutocracy controlling the language. It's so Orwellian, it smells of either Stalinist Russia or that other Germany that I'm not allowed to talk about. Young people who are in love, they make relationship decisions when everybody is either in fear of poverty or in poverty. They begin to make relationships decision based on who can provide them food, shelter, health care. And I guess for thousands of years, that was the basis for most relationships. But I like to think we evolved past that in the 20th century. You're from England, Great Britain, where at least there's universal health insurance. I would assume relationships in Great Britain, I'm talking about love, marriage, dating, I would assume in Great Britain, those relationships are much healthier because the people are healthier. They don't have to worry about...
Yeah, I have no idea on that one. I really don't know what the state of love is in England, but I will say the state of the healthcare system is better because you have universal healthcare. And that goes not just for England, but Canada, France, Germany, you name it. Every peer nation of ours does a better job of insuring its citizens against health catastrophe.
In America, you don't leave a job because there are benefits. So you stay at a lousy job, and your entrepreneurial spirit is squashed because you need the health benefits. And it destroys your work ethic, and it destroys the economy. How many relationships do you stay in because of, well, he or she is giving me health care, or I need her money, or I need the apartment?
It's a great question, and it would make for a fascinating PhD thesis, and I'm sure somebody somewhere has probably already written it. I don't know the answer to that, but you're absolutely right that people stay in relationships because their spouses have healthcare, they stay in jobs they don't like or don't need or don't want for any other reason apart from the fact that the healthcare is there. And one of the things that it does is it actually shrivels social mobility. So America likes, it's part of the American narrative that it's a particularly socially mobile country, and it used to be. But in recent decades, the data is actually very disturbing on social mobility. One of the most interesting pieces of data is that if you're born in poverty in 2013 in America, you're more likely to die in poverty than you would be if you were born in poverty in almost any other industrial economy.
Yeah.
And that's a profound shift because historically America has been the land of upward mobility. It's been the land of aspirations. And increasingly, that doesn't make sense as part of our narrative. And one of the reasons, not the only reason, but one of the reasons that social mobility has ground to a halt here is the healthcare crisis. You're absolutely right. People are staying in jobs and they're staying in locations for healthcare and for no other reason. And it's dysfunctional. And it triggers poverty and it triggers lots of other bad social consequences.
And they're staying in relationships because of healthcare or because of a house or money. And that is turning us into an increasingly hateful society that no longer understands what love is. And on that note, let's thank Sasha Abramsky. He's the author of a lot of great books, Inside Obama's Brain, Breadline USA. His latest book is published by Nation Books, The American Way of Poverty. You can get it at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and IndieBound. Sasha Abramsky, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you for having me on.
Are you enjoying today's show? I know I am. Well, there's a very simple way to say thank you, and that's by shopping at Amazon. Yes, that's right, Amazon. Make all your purchases at Amazon through the David Feldman Show website, and we'll get 6% of everything you purchase. It's a pretty good deal. Next time you want to buy something on Amazon, first go to the davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see an Amazon prompt. Trust me, you won't miss it. Click on the Amazon prompt and then shop away. 6% of all your purchases go towards keeping this program commercial free. The International March for Elephants took place across the country on October 4th to draw awareness to the plight of elephants in Africa. Joining us is one of the organizers of the International March for Elephants, Georgia Umano. Hello, Georgia.
Hi, David. Nice to talk to you.
Thank you for joining us. I'm sorry I couldn't go to the march on October 4th. The March for Elephants, this is not about the treatment of elephants in zoos or circuses. This is about the treatment of elephants in Africa. What's going on?
That's true. The African elephants are being slaughtered mercilessly every 15 minutes. Another one dies, 100 elephants a day. And it's because of their ivory. There are people who want to, they just kill them, and they chop off their faces and their tusks, and they smuggle it out, and mostly to Asian countries. There's a lust for ivory right now, and its value is worth higher than gold.
What countries specifically in Africa are we seeing most of this poaching?
Well, all the countries that have elephants are being hit hard. Even the ones that are very poor and have the fewest resources have been hit extremely hard. Recently, there was a cyanide poisoning of a lake in Zimbabwe, and we're told that 300 elephants plus other wildlife were killed because when an elephant dies, you know, predators come, the vultures come, the hyenas come and eat the elephants. Well, all those elephants died too. All those animals died also.
How many elephants are left in Africa right now?
There has been a rough estimate of 400,000, but recent research has showed there may only be as few as 200,000 left.
200,000 elephants are left, and we're losing how many a day?
We're losing 100 a day.
100 a day.
Yes.
Who is doing this? Who are the people who are doing this?
When you say who's doing it, I mean it's a multi-layered problem because there are the kingpins at the top, and those can often be terrorist groups because the terrorist groups like Al-Shabaab that recently was responsible for the slaughter in Kenya at the mall, they funded 40% of their funding came from ivory, you know, poaching elephants and selling the ivory to China and other Asian countries for the most part. Also, just people who want to buy the ivory. As I said, mostly Asian countries. China by far is the top country, but it also, in the United States, is the second highest user, surprisingly.
I thought you can't get piano keys anymore made from ivory. I thought it was against the law in the United States.
There are bans against it, but I was talking to Senator Ted Lieu. He said there is a ban, for example, in California, but there are a lot of loopholes in the ban, and he's going to be looking into that. In the city of Los Angeles, Councilman Koretz is going to be looking into putting in a stricter ban. It's getting through. There's a big black market, but then because there was a loophole in the law, as ivory was banned in the 80s for 15 years, but then there was a loophole that said certain countries could sell some of its stockpiles of old ivory. Well, that opened up the market, and it started the lust for ivory again.
And why is ivory so desirable?
In China, it's a traditional material from ancient times, the carved ivory. They have carved ivory schools, ivory carving schools, and they treasure it.
And why in the United States do people treasure ivory?
You know, I don't know. I'm assuming that a lot of it is from the Chinatowns in America. That's where you find shops that might have ivory items.
Right.
But other kind of sleazy entrepreneurs may be trying to cash in on this blood ivory right now.
And does China have laws forbidding ivory trade?
They say they do, but yet there's been underground investigations in China that show that the government itself has opened up ivory carving schools, which aren't even filled up yet.
So there is international law forbidding the trade of ivory, and yet the top players like the United States and China are not obeying these laws.
Correct. And it's multi-level. It's the people at the top, and then because there's so much poverty in Africa and people are not able to guard their wildlife, or people are not, the very poorest people have not really, some of them don't see how they profit from even having the animals there. So if somebody pays them off, they're willing to shoot a poison arrow at an elephant.
Right. And what people need to know is that elephants are more human than humans. They grieve for their dead. They care for their own. They're much more collaborative than humans
Absolutely,
show themselves
Dave.
To be. So you sponsored the International March for Elephants. It took place all over America on October 4th. What can
Not
we...
Not just America. It was all over the world. It was in 42 cities all over the globe.
Yeah. What can we do to stop this?
It's very frustrating, and we're thinking, what can one person do? What can I do? I know a person who's a one person who's made a big difference. He's a Kenyan man, Jim Justice Nyamu. He's been marching around Kenya, and now he started marching around the United States. He recently marched from Boston to Washington, just putting out his message that ivory belongs to elephants. And everywhere he went, he was greeted by mayors, he got to speak in schools, universities, and other people joined the march. I joined his march for a while also when he was in New York. We have to think of creative things to do. There's many people who are very worried about this right now. One of the major reasons for the marches was to really alert the local politicians to clamp down on any kind of trade locally. And that was one of the main reasons of it, as well as just to bring more global attention to the issue. We can write letters to our local politicians. We can write letters to all levels of government. Even President Obama has just promised $10 million to help fight poaching in Africa. The Clinton Foundation has promised to work with this, and they're raising $8 billion in the next 12 years. But it's so
$8 billion in the next 10 years. So that's about $800 million a year to do what?
Well, they're supposed to be trying to help fortify the rangers, for example, over in Africa. Now, you know, a lot of rangers in the last 10 years, I think about 1,000 rangers have been killed who were trying to protect the wildlife. It's just not the elephants. It affects so many layers of people, and it affects tourism in Africa.
It's kind of like the drug war, in that you have to fight the demand more than the supply.
One of the main things is stop the demand for ivory. Yeah. And so I don't know anybody who uses it personally, so that's you say, how do I do that? On Facebook, there's a lot of pages now that are devoted to elephants, helping elephants, getting the word out about elephants, what can we do about the elephants. And one of the new movements is called Flowers for Them, and October 25th to 28th, they're asking people to write to the Chinese embassy to send flowers, leave flowers at the gate, at the door of the embassies, and just say they were mourning the elephants.
Because okay, that's something that's coming up. So what can our listeners do to support the elephants? Repeat that, please.
This is just one idea that one person had, again, and then they're asking for more creative ideas, is on October 25th through the 28th to send four white flowers to the Chinese embassies. And if you go on Facebook, Flowers for Us, there's postcards you can print to put with that, or you don't even need that, and just say that these flowers are in memory of an elephant who died. And it's just another way to try to get through to some of the people at the top.
Anything else that you guys are doing to save the elephants that we can help with?
In my opinion, one of the top organizations is the David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust. That's an organization in Kenya started by Dame Sheldrick. Her husband was the first anti-poaching ranger. Her organization rescues baby elephants who are victims of poaching. Their mothers were killed. They would not survive on their own, and they bring them into the nursery, and they've discovered through trial and error a certain baby formula that works with them, and they have to be on this formula for 3 to 5 years. They have 24 hours a day care, and they eventually go back into another area in the park where they get to mingle with the wild elephants and eventually go back into the wild. It's a process that takes from 5 to 10 years. And this organization has put 130 baby elephants back out into the wild since it started. It's a wonderful organization.
But they we're also losing 100 elephants.
I know. That's
a
what
day.
I'm worried about, the elephants going back into the wild.
How
at
many
this
elephants
point.
Are we losing a day?
100.
So you give money to the David Sheldrick Trust, and over how many years they've put how many elephants back into the wild?
It's you know, you have to have faith and hope and do everything that you can, one foot in front of the other.
I understand that, but they've put I'm just trying to figure this out. Over how many years has the David Sheldrick Trust?
They've been there for, I don't remember the exact number, but it's a long time. It's over 20 years.
And over 20 years, they've put 100 elephants back into the wild.
130.
130.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
While every day, 100 are being massacred.
Today, correct. But each elephant is an individual, just like each person, you know, and they come to... Each elephant is well-loved. Their personality is known. And you can adopt a baby elephant for only $50 a year, and then you're one of many adopted parents because it takes $200 a month just to take care of a baby elephant.
Right.
And it's a wonderful thing to do.
Sure.
And an elephant, you know, when an elephant is born, its brain is 9 pounds.
Wow.
That's more than the average baby, human baby, when it's born, the whole body. And a lot of research has been done lately about elephants and how they communicate with each other. And it's a fascinating topic. And we just need to find a way to preserve our wonderful elephants. I believe they're more evolved than we are.
Of course,
you know, they've been on the earth millions of years longer than us. Their senses are more involved. That's why they have the trunks. Their trunk is so sensitive it can pick up a pin, and it can also pull out a trunk of a tree out of the earth. They communicate on so many different levels through the ground. They have rumbles through the ground. They have different sounds that we can hear and sounds that we can't even hear. Their auras are so big that they extend for 10 miles around them. They can tell when a friend is coming for 10 miles, but a human's is only for 2 miles. They can only tell a human's coming when it's 2 miles away. They're the most compassionate and the strongest animal.
They're big and compassionate.
Yes, they're the strongest and yet the most compassionate animal. And they have very well-organized societies, lots of communication, lots of love. They cry real tears. They're just a wonderful, wonderful animal when you get to know them. And
how did they end up being the symbol for the Republican Party then?
That's what I was going to say. Yeah, I think if you could hear what elephants were saying, and if they knew what was going on here, I think that's what they would say. Why do we have to be a symbol for Republicans?
Oh, that's saving 125 elephants. Each one is precious. Some would say more precious than humans. I just said it. And I probably believe that.
I'm with you there.
Sounds like we're losing, aren't we?
Well, I mean, if you look at it that way, you could say yes. But then if you look at all the people that are, I mean, just look at this march. That was the first time that the human beings, it was a historical march. The first time human beings have had a global gathering for another species. Okay? That was an idea that started at the David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust. Other ideas are popping up every day. There's people, when they learn about this, just as with other exploitation of animals, although this one is probably even in the most crisis, so many people don't even know what's going on right now regarding the elephants.
Right.
But if more and more people can find out, and I thank you so much for putting this on the radio, so more people can know about it, hopefully there'll be more of an outcry. You know, people will activate themselves more to find out ways that they can do something about it. I don't know what else to say. It's just, we have to have hope. We have to think positively or else they will all be killed. We have to keep doing whatever we can to save them.
You know, you're a kind, gentle person. And
thank you.
Care about animals. And I'm not a kind, gentle person.
Oh.
I'm angry, I'm pissed off, and I believe in attacking people, bad people. But I'm also a vegan, and I value animals sometimes more than I do human beings. And I come from a place of rage. And I think the problem we're up against is organizations that you're behind maybe don't have enough, they have too many kind people and not enough angry people. I like PETA. PETA's nice and angry.
Well, there are organizations, for example, in several countries now in Africa, they have told, and this is brand new in Tanzania, they have told the rangers if they see a poacher to shoot to kill. And they also can do that in Kenya and a few other places. They're selling them shoot to kill. So they're pretty angry too. But the only problem is the people that they're killing are these poor people who were paid off. They're $20 or whatever, and they're not killing the people who are making it happen at the top. That's always the problem, isn't it?
Yeah, when people loot downtown in the United States, the police are ordered to shoot to kill. I mean, that is something that those people are looting something more valuable than Main Street. Okay, so we've been talking with Georgia Umano. She is the spokesman and one of the organizers for the International March for Elephants. And at the end of the month, everybody should send a flower and a condolence card to the Chinese embassy.
The consulate, if it's in your city, like in Los Angeles, we do have a consulate in Chinatown.
If you can go there personally. Send flowers and a condolence card to mourn the deaths of the almost 1,000 elephants who die each week due to poaching. And the two biggest culprits in the world, as usual, when it comes to ivory, are China and the United States, right?
Yes. China is way above us, but still we are the second, surprisingly. Mm. So if you know of anybody who is in the China trade, report them.
The ivory trade.
And yes, and if you can write to your city council and tell them you're appalled and you want stricter action so this cannot happen in your city, same thing on the state level, same thing. I mean, we have to be activists today. There's so many horrible things happening that we can either sit here and be enraged and depressed, or we have to take action.
How many baby elephants have you adopted?
I have 4 baby elephants over there.
How old are they?
I was lucky enough to go over there 3 different years and see them grow. And, the oldest one is about 4 and a half, maybe 5, and the youngest one is just about under a year. They're just wonderful. When you adopt an elephant at the David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust, they send you the pictures, they send you a story, and you get to see little videos and pictures, and it's just the most adorable thing. And if you are lucky enough to be able to travel there, you get to spend time with your baby elephants. And it's just, to me, it was one of the very highlights of my whole life.
How do you spell Sheldrick?
It's Sheldrick. David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust. They're the ones who run the nursery. They run the camps also, where the teenage elephant, well, they're like teenagers. When they're about 3 to 4, they go out into the camp where they still have to receive milk and get caretaking, but not quite as much. When they're in the nursery, a person actually sleeps with them every night. They're never alone. When they're in the camp, they don't have that, but they still have lots of caretakers and the milk, and they go out on treks and they meet other elephants, and they slowly learn how to be wild again because, you know, elephants pass down their heritage. That's why it's so unbelievable. They're killing the biggest elephants. The ones with the biggest tusks are the oldest ones. Those are the ones that are full of wisdom that they pass down to the whole community. They're the ones who know how to act, where to go for the ancient roots. And that's another problem they're having, is that there's too many people. There's been a population explosion in Africa, and people are encroaching on their native lands that they've had for millions of years. So the elephants are walking through the farm fields, and then that makes them not like the elephants and wanting to kill them.
Right. And where is this wildlife trust? What country?
It's in Kenya.
Kenya, that's right.
Yes.
And is David Sheldrick no longer with us?
No, he was actually the first ranger of the Kenya Wildlife Service who was very involved with anti-poaching. This was back in the 80s. 70s and 80s, he and his wife lived out in the, you know, in the forest there, and she always would take in little orphaned wildlife. And when he passed away at an early age, she started the David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust in his honor, and she has become well known for learning how to raise an elephant. Each one that comes there, she and her family, her daughter also takes care of it now, and her grandchildren, they know each elephant as an individual. Each elephant has a name. They know its history. They write it down. They document everything. And this is all something that you can have access to online. It's the most beautiful thing. And all the people who work there, all the caretakers who spend all day with the elephants every day, they're the most loving people I have ever met. I mean, they love the elephants. And these are people who are, they come from mostly poor backgrounds. Their families are some other area of the country. They only get 4 days a month off, and they travel long distances to see their families. And then they come back, and then they say, you know, I have two families. I have my family at home, and I have my elephants. And
yeah, I didn't realize how much work goes into raising an elephant.
Oh, yes. It's amazing. I mean, because they're just like a human baby. You know, a baby elephant is like a human baby. It's kind of helpless. It needs guidance. It needs lots of attention. They're very emotional. I mean, a lot of the baby elephants that they rescue from poaching situations, they're so heavily traumatized because they've watched their mother, their aunts, their uncles being slaughtered horribly, that they never come out of it, and they just can't make it.
Are elephants carnivores?
No, not at all. They're vegans, baby.
Really?
They eat the grasses. In fact, they say elephant is a keystone species, they say, because it's because of the elephants that we have many of the forests, because the elephants walk around. They walk usually in the wild they can walk over 100 miles a day. And they're picking berries, they're picking grasses, and then as they go along, they're pooping that out. And the poop becomes fertilizer, and the seeds actually start growing as soon as they come back out again. And so they're actually spreading the greens and the forestry around, and without them, there'd be a lot more desert.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Well, 125 elephants have been put out into the wild by the David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust, and that's 125 elephants we need. And it's not enough, because
no,
they're killing 100 a day.
Right.
Human beings.
Yeah.
Human beings.
I know, it makes you cry.
Human beings. Well, we've been talking with Georgia Umano, and thank you, Georgia. Please come back real soon, and let's see if we can't help the David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust and draw more attention to the plight of elephants.
Thank you so much for having me. Yes, I really love spreading the word and helping other people to realize how wonderful elephants are and what danger they're in.
Thanks. My show is spreading the word much the same way elephants spread fertilizer.
Right.
One drop at a time. Thank you, Georgia.
Right. Thank you, David.
The David Feldman Show is available as a podcast for free on iTunes. I invite you to friend me on Facebook, and please follow me on Twitter. If you're listening to this program as a podcast and would like to hear it broadcast, I ask you to contact your local public radio station and say, I want the David Feldman Show. Our executive producer is Troy Conrad. Our producer is Alicia Cordova. Don't forget to sign up for my free newsletter by going to davidfeldmanshow.com, where you'll also find a treasure trove of podcasts and radio shows dating back to 2009. It's all free. Special thanks to Matt Perez, Stan, Tamika, Ali, Lexa, Jimmy Dore, and of course, Alan Minsky from the KPFK Studios in Southern California. I'm David Feldman. Thank you for joining us.